mother's child is gonna spawn to see if reindeer really know how to fly. And so I'm offering the simple phrase to kids from 1 to 92. Although it's been said many times, many ways, Merry Christmas to you.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to Woodlawn United Church on this, the fourth Sunday of Advent, the Sunday that we celebrate and light the candle of love on our Advent. Wherever you are, I hope you are keeping well as we move back to online worship only as the case numbers rise here in the province of Nova Scotia and here in the central region. And certainly we want to do our part to make sure that people can have a gift of good health through this Christmas time. And so here we are in this way. And wherever you are, I hope that we do feel connected by that greater great spirit that comes to live and be among us in the one we celebrate, in the one whose birth we celebrate just a week from now. And as we gather as a United Church of Canada congregation, we acknowledge that with gratitude we live in worship on lands that are by law the unceded territory of the Mi'kmaq. May we live with respect on this land and in peace and friendship with its people. So as I said, it is hoped that as we make this sacrifice to forego in-person worship and move to online only, that we do offer one another hopefully a gift of good health through this Christmas season. And we are mindful of ones who do not have that gift right now, ones who are in hospital and ones who are struggling with illness. And so we do continue to hold them in our prayers. And also those who mourn the loss of loved ones. And this past week, I learned of the recent death of Joan Dempsey. And many Woodlawn folks will remember Joan. Her husband, Ron Dempsey, was minister here at Woodlawn United for a number of years. And also, I want to pass along the news of the death of Ian Ferguson. Now, Ian wasn't a member of Woodlawn. He was a member of Iona Presbyterian, but he served for many years as the chair of the East Dartmouth Christian Food Bank. And certainly, as we think of the lives of people like Ian and Joan, we think of ones whose lives made a difference because of the faith that they lived. And so we give thanks for their lives of faith. And we hold in our prayers all who mourn their loss. I want to thank you for the ways that you continue to be the church through this time. I know people are so good to reach out to others by a phone call or an email. Your financial gifts of support to the church mean a great deal as we move through these uncertain pandemic times, and we never know, of course, what's around the corner, but certainly your gifts of support make such a great deal of difference at this time. And just a couple of notes around that, there are offering envelopes that are available for pickup from the church if you have not received yours yet. And if you would like to make a contribution to the church to count towards your 2021 tax contributions, that can be done before the end of the year. So thank you again for sharing those gifts. And just a note about our online services, Christmas Eve, we will have two services live streamed at 4 p.m. and 8 p.m. Recordings will be available. But if you wish to participate in communion at the 8 p.m. service, please have some juice and a piece of bread or cracker on hand as we celebrate the gift of the sacrament with our Christmas Eve services, the 8 p.m. service this Friday evening. So friends, here we are in this way, in this season, and God calls us to give worship and praise. And so I invite you to meditate or say with me the words of our call to worship today. We come before the Holy One. Sometimes we are awestruck. Sometimes we are doubtful. We hear a voice calling our names. Sometimes we are apprehensive. Sometimes we are comforted. Today we ask that our fears be quelled, our ears ready to listen, and our hearts and minds open to the one who has nothing but love for us. As we journey through this Advent season and await the celebration of Christmas and the love of Christ to be born anew in us, may our worship inspire us to an even greater celebration given. And let us reflect together on the words of our first carol, "People Look East." Okay. Move over for the lighting of the Advent candle. We seem to have run into a technical difficulty this morning, but you know, I have my heart goes out to our tech team who are so dedicated and able to be here to help with these online services. And so thank you, team, for your work today and coming out in this snowy weather to be here. And as we gather to light this Advent wreath today, we light the candle of love. There is no greater power in life or in death than love. It's amazing what we can do when we know we are loved. The scriptures say God so loved the world that he gave his Son so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but have everlasting life. In Jesus, we have learned that love is found in the giving. So in Advent, we wait for love by giving it, knowing that there is no greater gift. We seek to live as a people of love, sharing that which was first shared with us. So we light this candle to symbolize the love we have in Christ's presence. We gather to share this love with one another. Thank you. let us pray. O Holy One, once again we find ourselves scattered, living in the midst of this pandemic. But as we gather to worship, may we find ourselves woven together by the strength of your love. And help us, through the gift of this love, to find our strength not only to live each day, but to live each day for one another. That we might be a people of love, of justice, of kindness, and peace. And to live and grow into the realm that you have called us to live and grow into. By calling us each by name, through Christ, the one who taught us and others to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. I want to thank Mary Osborne, who would have been here this morning to read our minute for mission, but for providing this minute for mission with us today. It's entitled, Share Your Light. As you know, holidays like Christmas, Boxing Day, and New Year's can be an incredibly difficult time for those on the margins of society. People without family, friends, or a place to go. The spirit of giving, receiving, and celebration can only make feelings of isolation and loneliness worse for some. Especially for people without community, those dealing with a health crisis, or those who are not financially stable. The pandemic has made things worse, and the need to help transform and save lives and provide support to those who are most vulnerable is critical. Did you know that Boxing Day was originally a day to give rather than to receive? Before Boxing Day became associated with turkey sandwiches, football, and discounts, it was known as a day to serve people in need. Historically, the church visited those most vulnerable on Boxing Day to give them money and gifts. A day not about giving, but about giving our best. And when you make a gift through mission and service, you are aligning yourself with the roots of this day, a day that calls us to compassion. Our world desperately needs our care. For some, it means everything. Your support through mission and service means that an individual named David, who lost his entire family after a series of accidents, was able to rebuild his life with the help of the Bissell Center, a mission and service partner. Our partnership with organizations like the Kenya Alliance for Advancement of Children, it breaks down barriers, paves the way for eager students to go to school. Your gifts help to end these cycles of stigma and poverty and give hope for future. Your generosity means the isolated seniors living alone and in poor health not only receive access to services, but know what it is to feel seen and cared for. Giving is about more than making a gift. It is about lighting a way for these others. So it's up for every one of us, up to one of one of us to be the light. Light in the lives of those who are suffering. Together we can be the difference our world needs. So thank you for your generosity. And God bless you for sharing your light in all the ways that you do. Our scripture reading this morning from Luke is often referred to as Mary's Song of Praise. It is also known as the Magnificat. And it is called the Magnificat because with her song, Mary's soul magnifies the Lord. She seeks to enlarge the work and the presence of the God she refers to as the Mighty One. So let us hear again this reading from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 1, verses 46 to 55. And Mary said, "My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior. For he has looked with favor on the lowliness of his servant. Surely from now on all generations will call me blessed. For the Mighty One has done great things for me, and holy is his name. His mercy is for those who fear him from generation to generation. He has shown strength with his scattered the proud in the thoughts of their hearts. He has brought down the powerful from their thrones and lifted up the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away empty. He has helped his servant Israel in remembrance of his mercy, according to the promise he made to our ancestors, to Abraham and his descendants forever." God's word is a lamp to our feet and a light to our path. Let us pray. Eternal and everlasting God, in whom we live and move and have our being, we gather again as your people. We know there is much in this world to distract us and to keep us far from you. And so we pray that as we gather and as we have sung words of praise and offer words of prayer, as we reflect on words of scripture and words that have been prepared and pondered, as we offer the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts, that we might discover anew your word to us. And on this Sunday of Advent in which we celebrate the gift of love, may it be a word of love. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. So this morning I want to begin by considering this word magnify. We just heard of Mary's Magnificat. And when I think of magnify, some may think of a detective with a magnifying glass, but I think of a telescope and some of the images that we receive from deep space, you know, that help to reveal those mysteries of the universe. Mysteries that include things that, you know, once were considered to be impossible, such as this image I have up on the screen this morning, and I appreciate it may not be easy to make out. It's rather dark in ways, but this image was taken by the Very Large Telescope located in Chile. Now, I know that's a creative name for the telescope, but it is seriously called the Very Large Telescope. And it's actually a picture taken a few weeks ago of a double star system. And it's a picture of a planet that's orbiting in this system. Seeing this magnified image for the first time a few weeks ago, most astronomers did not think such a planet in this instance could exist. They thought it was impossible. So I want you to think about that for a moment. Because the image that you hopefully see on the screen is something that most experts thought only a few short weeks ago was impossible. Professor Marcus Jansen, he's an astronomer at the University of Stockholm. He calls this a mystery. And one of his colleagues noted how astronomers over the past 10 years or so, because of these bigger telescopes, that they're becoming used to these types of mysteries. they've noticed how, you know, things like the Hubble telescope and the Very Large Telescope, and there was another one that went up this past week, the Webb, that each one probes deeper into space, magnifies things in such a way that leads to more questions, even more discoveries, and more wonder as the mystery deepens and their view of the universe, is transformed. It's amazing how, when things are magnified, how our perspective and even our thinking can be changed. And I think that, you know, this sense of mystery, it's not only true when we look through a telescope, it's true when we can open our eyes and open our hearts and open our minds and turn our attention even to the world around us. I mean, as a people of faith, when we are willing to go deeper, to expand our view, we discover how a life that is authentically lived in faith, it's one in which we are really called to abide in a mystery, the mystery of God. But you see, one of the challenges of living faithfully is that this divine presence, you know, like those deep galaxies out there in space, the divine presence is not easily discerned for us in our lives. I mean, there are times when we either fail to sense, or maybe we just choose to ignore the mysterious divine presence that is around us. Times when maybe we feel as if we've got all the answers. And so we can fall prey to a smallness of vision or a narrow-mindedness because we just don't want to look deeper. And there are times when, because of this, we lose a sense of mystery and of wonder in our lives. We lose our sense of awe about the world around us, about how something could be possible. But because we are unable to see it, we just write it off as being impossible. And we miss the mystery. And I appreciate how this pandemic time, it's brought with it many mysteries, many questions. Questions, you know, that we wish we had answers for. And it's frustrating, you know, to me and to many I know, we find ourselves not being able to worship in person at this time of year. And I appreciate that as this new wave comes upon us, that this may be a time when more are starting to believe a world without a pandemic is impossible. But I do pray that we hold on to that sense and that hope of possibility, not only for ourselves, but for others. And it's one of the reasons why I want us to consider this morning this power and the importance of having a faith that can magnify, a faith that can help to draw us into a different kind of mystery and to wonder about something else, to consider the things we focus on in our lives and what we choose to make large. You know, in this season, when once again the pandemic looms large, as a people of faith, Christmas gives us an opportunity to magnify something else. We're reminded of this God-given gift to wonder about something else, and become immersed in a different kind of mystery. I mean, having this sense of wonder when it comes to things like beauty, truth, and love, it's good for the soul. The Greater Good Science Center at Berkeley University has reported that, you know, awakening that sense of wonder within us not only helps us appreciate things like the beauty of nature or the cosmos. Having a sense of wonder and mystery in our lives can help heal a sense of loneliness or isolation. It can bring us closer to one another. See, it cultivates a healthy humility that allows us to see beyond ourselves, that we might perhaps see how the divine is at work in our midst. You know, a sense of wonder. People have valued this sense for a long time. In the wisdom books of the Bible, for example, in the book of Proverbs, the importance of a sense of wonder as it relates to living and to life and to faith, it can be discerned in the words of a fellow named Agur. Have you ever heard of Agur in the book of Proverbs? Well, maybe you've heard what Agur wrote. He said, "There are three things too wonderful for me, four that I cannot understand. The way of an eagle in the sky, the way of a snake on a rock, the way of a ship at sea, and the love between two people." Now, I mention this because, you know, not a lot, when you think about it, is actually recorded in the Bible. But the scriptures make a point of remembering these words of Agur, a man who was remembered for his sense of wonder and awe, his ability to behold the mystery of little things that many people might just take for granted or overlook or never really see. For him, they were too wonderful to understand. You see, from early on, the life-giving nature of wonder, of awe, it's embedded in our scriptures. You see, sometimes instead of letting things be wonderful or large or mysterious, we human beings, we can do everything in our power to try to belittle and diminish or downsize things. You know, it's like we want to flip that telescope around and, you know, instead of looking through the small end out to the big, we look out the big end, look through the big end and want to make things small. Maybe we do this at times because we're afraid. We're afraid of things becoming too big. Or maybe in our eyes, they are too big and we want to make them small. You know, I wonder sometimes if this is why many are afraid to let God work through their lives. I mean, there are those who, in this world, who think that God, for example, is some sort of scary monster, that God is to be feared. And yes, the scriptures do speak of fearing God. Mary speaks of it in her Magnificat. But it's meant in a way in which God is to be revered, to be respected. But there are many, you see, who harbor this different kind of fear, this unhealthy fear of God that distorts and interferes a relationship with God and also with others. Recently, I read an article written by a mental health nurse, and she'd been studying some of the images of God that adults possess. And she found these fearful, primal pictures that populated people's minds when it came to God. And she recorded people saying things like, "God has a mean face. You know, I don't like to think of God looking at me." That God is big and God is angry for some unknown reason. I imagine there are some who think that now about God in the midst of the pandemic. And we can make things large and scary and daunting. I mean, there's even that condition called megalophobia, right? The fear of large things. Because we don't like it when things are too big. And there can be a lot of pressure when things get big. There can be pressure to perform, to live up to somebody else's standards, live up to expectations. And there's also this pressure to maintain control, you see. I mean, is it any wonder that there are times when we just want to keep things small or cut them down to size? Because keeping things small helps us stay in control. Because we only end up having to trust ourselves, you see. But you know, at its worst, that kind of behavior, what it can do, it can bullying. It can lead to the belittling of others because we want to cut people down to size. And it's usually rooted in fear. The fear of things being bigger than me in this universe. By the way, that can actually be a very lonely universe to be in. Because it's the universe where you want to be the biggest thing. And if that's the case, then you're definitely cutting yourself off from God and from the wonder of God. And chances are, you're cutting yourself off from others as well. You know, it can be a struggle at times, and especially at Christmas. Because there are so many who struggle to have that Christmas they can control. You know, that Christmas they want. They don't want Christmas actually to get too big because they want something they can manage, get the right gifts, make sure all the things on the list are checked off and so on. But you see, Christmas is so much bigger than that, bigger than our agendas or our wish lists. It's bigger than a pandemic. There's a mystery behind this gift of Christmas. And unless we find ourselves in the light of that mystery, unless we immerse ourselves in its awe, with awe and wonder, the deeper meaning and connection it can bring to our lives will elude us. You know, as author Rachel Carson wrote, she said, you know, those who dwell among the beauties and the mysteries are never alone or weary of life. Whatever the vexation or concerns of their personal lives, their thoughts can find paths that lead to inner contentment and to renewed excitement in living. You see, what Carson is saying is this. She's saying, you know, instead of magnifying ourselves or even belittling others, there comes a point when we magnify God and we make the wonder of God our awe-inspiring inspiration. You know, over these past months, years now, I found myself needing to be reminded time and again that no matter how big this pandemic is, at the end of the day, and even at the end of life, I need to remember that God is bigger. Right in the midst of the challenges, I need to let the mystery of God's love just be loosed and let it make a difference. You see, a part of our mission as a people of faith is to identify, you know, what is it that we are to magnify? So that we not only make a difference, but we really allow the mystery of God's love to make a difference. I mean, this is what Mary does in her life, in this text we hear from Luke. Mary magnifies, and God knows that Mary made a difference in the process. When Mary hears the words of a heavenly message and believes she is to bear the Son of God, the Son, by the way, who spent his whole life magnifying the one he called his Father in heaven. Well, we might expect that when Mary hears the news that she was pregnant, that she might just quietly slink away in fear. I mean, she wouldn't want to have been magnified in her culture. She was a young woman, unwed, with a child. I mean, if she knew her place, she wouldn't have said anything. I mean, for her, in her context, there would have been a great deal of shame associated with her predicament. She was a young woman, a girl, to have been pitied and could have very easily been belittled by others. Mary has every reason to lay low and sing small, but she doesn't. She doesn't. Instead, she sings aloud. And when she sings aloud, she magnifies God and God's love for her and God's love for others. for so many like her who find themselves often belittled by the world and left on the margins, right? With this voice of courage, God is who Mary decides to make large. Even in the midst of the undesirable, shameful, compromising situation that she finds herself in, she says, "My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior." Now imagine if you made those words the first words that came out of your mouth when you got out of bed each day. You know, in a world where so many magnify so many other things, I mean, even themselves, I mean, how about living that kind of life that magnifies God? I mean, it would be like singing your own Magnificat, right? As soon as you get out of bed in the morning, your feet hit the floor, and you say, "My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior." Say that. I mean, Mary, she said it. And I guess she knew her scriptures when she said that. At least her Psalms, because, you know, the Psalms are full of verses that speak of the magnificence of God. Say the Psalm 145 says that God is magnificent. He can never be praised enough. You know, another Psalm says, "Lord, our Lord, how magnificent is your name throughout the earth." Or in Psalm 92, it says, "How magnificent are your works, O Lord. How profound your thoughts." Right? Mary knew as a woman of faith that if there was anything in her life worth magnifying, it was God, the Magnificent One. It was God who looked upon her with favor. It was the Mighty One who would do great things for her. And it's not just any God here. This is the God of Israel, the God who is merciful, who wondrously has the power to unseat the proud and lift up the lowly, the God who mysteriously has filled the hungry and sent the rich away empty, the one whose mysterious presence makes the seemingly impossible possible. I mean, Mary, as a young woman, as a woman of faith, she understood if we humans are to have hope, to have justice and joy, we need to start with God and the mystery of what God can do. And you see, this is a great message and spirit to carry with us through this Christmas season and the year that is to come. I mean, this is a Christmas when, you know, at Christmas time, people can make their credit card bills large. Maybe you eat a little more than you should and your waistline gets a little large. And goodness knows, with the ongoing specter of this pandemic, there will be magnified case counts and it will continue to loom large in the news. So I pray that in the midst of that we remember that joy of Mary and her Magnificat and this opportunity we have in our life, just as she had in hers, to magnify God. A God who in Christ seeks to reconnect us with that divine mystery of what love has done and what love can do. I mean, let's be the ones who magnify the love that gives way to wonder. I mean, our song may not sound like Mary's. We each have our own song, but I mean, maybe, you know, there's other who sing songs of they sing their own Magnificats. I want to quote one for you this morning from the band U2. Now, through the years, the Irish band U2, the lead singer Bono, they've never been shy to talk about their Christian faith. They sing of a God who lifts up the lowly. They've raised awareness of captives who need to be set free, of hungry who need to be filled. U2 magnifies the presence of God in many and much of their lyrics, like they do so in a song that's called Magnificent. And whereas Mary referred to God as the Mighty One, you too names God as Magnificent. And they sing, I was born to sing for you. I didn't have a choice but to lift you up and sing whatever song you wanted me to. I give you back my voice. From the womb, my first cry, it was a joyful noise. And justified till we die, you and I will magnify the magnificent, magnificent. Thanks be to God. Grateful for the many ways that we continue to support the life and the work of the Church both here and around the globe. So this morning we pause to dedicate our offering this day. Let us pray. O gracious and generous God, you have given us so much. You give us the gift of your very self and the coming of Christ. And so as we reflect on all that we have been given, as we magnify the ways you have sought to make each of us large through your generosity and grace towards us, we now present back to you these gifts, that they may be used to magnify your name, to build your kingdom, to lift up the lowly, to feed the hungry, and to make your love known. Amen. I invite you now to bow your heads, to breathe deeply, that we might hold together in our spirit of prayer this morning, our prayers to God, our prayers for others, prayers for ourselves. Let us pray. O God of grace, thank you for this Advent season of waiting, of wonder. Thank you for the beauty of the sleeping earth, waiting for spring's new life. Thank you for the joy of children, waiting for the excitement of gift-giving. Thank you for the gift of carols and of joyful music that touches warming and waiting hearts. Thank you for family and friends. thank you for the gift of Jesus Christ, for the life in him, and the wonder of his love. We pray for all who are waiting this morning. People in this world who are waiting for an end to hostility. Ones who are worn out by conflict. People who are waiting for healing because they live with sickness and pain. People who are waiting for good news because they are weighed down with sorrow. We pray for all the earth that is waiting. Creatures who are waiting for protection. Lands that are waiting to be redeemed from pollution. Ones waiting for a safe, affordable place to live. Ones waiting for acceptance to be who they are. Ones waiting for an end to isolation. Ones waiting for test results. Ones waiting for a vaccine. Ones waiting to see loved ones again. Ones waiting for freedom from anxiety and uncertainty. Ones waiting for grief to end and a new day to dawn. Ones waiting to be free. Throughout the world, in it and on it and under it, waiting happens, waiting grows and gathers. For the earth and its inhabitants are waiting for redemption. And as your people, O God, and as believers in the life found in you in your great mystery, in our merry Christmases, may we make peace, and in our season's greetings, may we share a welcome, and in our happy new year, may we sow seeds of justice, extend mercy, and live knowing your promise makes way to your future. May we live as ones who magnify you with our being. May we believe not in some fanciful magic or false hope, but in a vision that is a way of life rooted in love for us, love for our children, for our neighbors, for strangers, for enemies, for all people. For this love is our help for generations to come, just as it has been for generations past. For with Christmas you give us your humanity and our true humanity. You give us your childhood and ours. Our stories, our lives, our fears, our joys, our hopes and dreams intersect with each other and you as you come to us and we come to the Christ child. You declare a message of peace and goodwill, a message that is our blessing, and may we bless others through it in faith. Friend and stranger alike, we pray it in Jesus' name, the one we call our Savior and friend. Amen.
Thank you.
Let us live as a people of hopeful anticipation. Christmas is coming. Love is on the way. May we be ready to receive, to share, to celebrate and magnify the gift of Christ. God's great love shown for all the earth. As we leave this time together and journey towards that blessed day, let us not hide, but share our gifts, great and small, as we make large the spirit that lifts up the lowly, fills the hungry with good things, and helps God's people in remembrance of his mercy. And as you go, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May God's face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. And may our Lord shower you with kindness and give you peace. Amen.